Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel where we create photorealistic assets together. We are at the last part of our course and we're going to talk about rendering today. Specifically, we're going to talk about rendering for a texture artist. If you were to ask me what's the difference between rendering for a texture artist versus a look dev artist, for me personally, I like to adjust all my maps inside of Mari instead of my rendering engine. In theory, either way should work. If I change my maps, obviously my material is going to start to look different. Or if you adjust nodes inside of your rendering engine, your material start to look different. Since I build my map in a way that's completely non-destructive and I can basically manipulate any elements inside of my texture, I find it in general just easier to adjust everything inside of Mari. I do use adjustment nodes inside of my rendering engine sometimes, maybe by the end, but I find it in general it's just easier for organization if I just do all the changes on my maps. If I have adjustment nodes going on at the same time in my rendering engine and I'm adjusting my maps at the same time, sometimes can get pretty confusing. Because of all these reasons, over the years, I have just been manipulating my materials from changing my maps. Obviously, that doesn't have to be the way you do it, but I find it in general for texture artists, because you have the maps already, you have the ability to change them however you want already. In general, it's a bit easier. So, rendering. What are the main steps we have to focus on? First thing we have to do is to set up a basic lighting, and I find it's very easy to just start with the HDR. If you find a good HDR, I find that you can do the bulk of your rendering just using one HDR and then add whatever light you want later. The next thing we will do is to create basic materials. We will plug in our maps and see if everything is working properly. Next, we're going to start to adjust all the settings on our shader. In general, I use 3 to 4 maps for each shader, so there's a lot of area settings that we're just going to give it a flat color or a flat number. After that, we're going to learn how to tweak our maps and see our material change inside of our rendering engine. Finally, we're going to do some simple color correction for our final render. Enough rambling, let's get into the video itself. The first thing we have to do is that I'm going to generate my supporting maps, mostly bump and roughness, from my diffuse map. First, I will create a roughness map and I will create the backdrop for it. Sorry, this part is going to be sped up because the whole recording for just converting different maps is like 34 minutes. I'm going to have a fast version for this, and if you need something that's a bit slower, easier to understand, I have another video for that, and I will link it down below. So the basic idea of converting your diffuse map into, let's say, a roughness map, is that I basically have to build the roughness map the exact same structure of how I build my diffuse. I will have all the different layers of material, and also I will link every type of layer material to their material masks, so I have full flexibility to manipulate my roughness map. This is the reason why I create radio transmitter node for most of my material masks, so that I can plug them into many different channels. Once I duplicated the entire structure from my diffuse map, I will first of all have a luminance node for the entire connection, because obviously roughness map is black and white, and most likely I will have a HSV layer before each texture. The reason why we're going to have HSV layer in front of every material is because we have to kind of switch our mind from thinking about color texture into thinking about the value of each material and how that's going to look in terms of roughness. We need the ability to adjust the value for each material. Because we're using the same material masks we created before, we should have the ability to control everything. In terms of roughness, anything that's darker, it's going to be more reflective and the speck is going to be sharper. And anything brighter, the surface is going to be rougher and you're going to have less speck. This is what my roughness map looks like by the end. And this is very temp map. I will only know if this works after I start testing it. So I'm not wasting too much time in this step. Once I start testing, there's going to be a lot of changes I will have to do. The next map I will create is the bump map, and the idea is exactly the same. I will have to rebuild my entire material structure according to what I have in my diffuse map. But this time, it's also black and white map, and I will also have HSV layer in front of every material. But this time, I will be thinking about more in terms of the bumpiness of the surface and which material is on top and which material is on the bottom. And that's how I'm going to decide what value material I will have. For a bump map, you always start with 50% gray. And a little trick I like to use is to set my Mari background to 50%. So I always know where that is. And anything that's bumpy is going to be brighter than 50%, and anything that's more like a scratch or anything that goes below the mid-level is going to be darker than 50%. This is what it roughly looks like in the end, and same idea, I will have to test it to know if it works, so it really doesn't matter how it looks right now. Now the map is ready for rendering, we're going to export it out of Mari. And in general, I just go to the channel and right click on it and choose export flattened, export current channel flattened. And that's how I get my maps out of Mari. Now let's go into Maya and look at the setup of the render. So this is the basic setup I have. I have one light, a dome light with HDR on it, and I have a backdrop. And for the backdrop, it's a very simple material, not very reflective and kind of bright. And if you render it, there is no material on the object right now, but we can see that the HDR is working, the backdrop is working, and we do have enough light to start testing out our maps. I love rendering in Arnold. It's so simple to start. I barely need to adjust anything and the render is already looking very good. For this specific asset though, I have to use layer shader for it because I have my paint on top of metal. So I will create one metal shader and I will create one paint shader, and I'm going to combine them with the layer shader inside of Arnold. And this is the material mask I'm going to export and use for that purpose. And this is also the material mask that we spend most our time on to break up the paint. Back in Arnold, the first shader I'm going to create is the layer shader. I will assign this shader to the entire object. And inside a layer shader, I can choose to connect it to an Arnold standard shader. And the first one we're going to use is for the metal. We're going to start to plug in some texture for this. And first we're going to connect a color map. I like to choose off for filter type so that there's no blurring. And we're going to navigate to where we saved the maps. Under UV tiling mode, choose UDIM. So it will use all the maps that has the correct naming convention from Mari. In terms of color space, I was working under sRGB inside of Mari. So I'm going to keep it consistent in here and I should see the exact same color. Next, I actually enabled another layer on my layer shader and I'm going to connect another Arnold standard shader to it, and this one is going to be for the paint. And I will also connect the diffuse map for the paint quickly. The reason why I'm doing this right now is because I want to test out my material masks between these two different materials, see if it works before I do any more adjustment on each material. So under mix in the second material, I'm connecting to my material mask. Same, I will change the filter type and change it to UDIM format. I'm renaming some of my texture nodes for clarification so I know what everything is. For this paint material mask, because it's a black and white map, I will expand on the texture node where it says out color, and I will plug the red channel into the mask slot. And so that we can make sure it's using the luminance value. I do the same procedure for all the black and white maps. Now we render again. We should be able to see the mix between the paint and the metal. It's definitely working. We can move on to the next step. Okay, confession time. I don't know why I was separating the diffuse map for the metal and the paint. Somehow I thought I need two different maps, but really I just need one diffuse map, the one I did inside of Mari, everything together for two different materials. I guess I just haven't used layer shader for a while, and that was pretty stupid. But when you really think about it, what's gonna separating those two materials are the material mask, and we have that. So in terms of diffuse, we can just use the same map, and same for the roughness, and same for the bump. So here I'm connecting the rest of the maps that I painted. Mostly it's just diffuse, roughness, and bump. For the bump, we do need a bump 2D node to connect into the bump slot inside of each shader before we can connect to the actual bump texture. I will also only connect the red channel for the bump texture. Now we have all the maps plugged in, we're gonna start to adjust the settings for each material a little bit. For the IOR of the metal, I set it at 1.75. And I know people are gonna leave comments. I'm supposed to have steel, bronze, and iron inside of it. Why do you use one IOR for everything? Why don't you actually have an IOR map to change the value? I'm sorry guys, I'm not being too precise with this project. You are more than welcome to add as many material as you like for your metal. But here, when I say I wanted to have iron, bronze, and copper for my material, it's mostly for the color breakup. So in terms of what I can see, there's a good variety in terms of metal, but I'm just not being too precise with it. And if you want to leave comments, go ahead. I would love to learn from everyone as well, and whatever I'm doing here is just something that's been working for me and I want to share with everybody. Obviously, there's so much more that I still need to learn myself, so I'm never coming from a place where I'm telling you what to do or I think I know everything. No, not at all. So this is looking all shiny and weird. We definitely need to do a lot of adjustments. One thing I like to do with metal is to give the spec a little bit of a color. Not every metal needs a spec color, but most of them do. So for this imaginary metal that I have, I'm going to give you the spec color. First, I'm going to just test it with the diffuse map and see what it looks like. My spec color before was pretty bright, so once I use the actual diffuse map, everything becomes super dull. So this is definitely not the look I'm going for either. Back in Mari, I'm creating a new channel for the spec color, which is basically the bare metal color with some color adjustments. In general, I'm just making it a little bit brighter and a little bit more saturated. Looks pretty good to me, and I'm gonna test this one out. I'm plugging in the new spec color and rendering again. There's a little bit more shine to it, and I think there's a bit more color to the metal. But I don't think that's enough. I just want to mention that the kind of metal we're working on here is heavy metal. So we actually do see a lot of the color from the metal itself. It does not actually reflect too much. So I'm mostly focusing on adjusting the color itself. Back in Mari, I'm gonna adjust this color a little bit more, making it even brighter and give it a little bit more color. And I'm gonna test this one out again, and hopefully we'll see a little bit more shine to the metal. I want to assess the metal on its own, so I'm not using layer shader at the moment, and I'm changing the diffuse color for just a bare metal, just to see what the diffuse looks like versus with a spec color on what it looks like. It still looks pretty dull, so I'm changing my IOR a little bit just to see what it does. I definitely like this much better. As you can see, I'm adjusting my IOR according to what I see, not necessarily according to what the scientific number is. Definitely don't do this if you're doing a serious project, but for a personal project like this, I really just care what it looks like. You can also see how many color and detail is on my metal. Like I said before, my texture style is heavy-handed, and this is the kind of look I like personally, so definitely don't follow this if this is not what you like to do. Now I'm semi-happy with what the metal looks like, I'm gonna turn the paint back on and start to adjust the paint material. For the paint, the basic texture plugged in is looking pretty decent. I definitely want something that's way more matte than the metal itself, so you get that nice contrast between shiny metal and matte paint. I'm rendering everything all together just to see what kind of adjustments I still have to do. I actually went back into Mari and make the color a little bit more saturated and bright. It's a little too dull all over right now. This definitely looks much better. I'm skimming through a lot of stuff because the rendering part is actually very long. Maybe when I have time eventually, I will upload a full version on my Gumroad for free. Once you start rendering, it's also the time you're gonna start to see a lot of problems with the texture. I realize there's a lot of kind of artifacts around this area that I'm supposed to have a shinier edge and it's kind of breaking it, so I'm cleaning it up as well. I think I'm pretty happy with everything at this point. So far, I'm still only using one HDR, so I think it's time we can add extra light and some extra spec for this asset. This lighting in general is quite simple, just a very simple studio light with a backdrop, so nothing super artistic and complex about it, but it definitely does the job. That is pretty much everything I want to show you in the rendering process. I hope that's a helpful course for you. I know the rendering part is a little bit too brief, probably not specific enough, and I didn't show you every adjustment I did. It was just way too long, and we're already at 17 minutes. Really sorry about that. If you like this kind of content, please like and subscribe, and I will see you in the next one.